This is Terms of Reference. I'm your host, Stephen Laddick. Deirdre White is a globally recognized leader in building tri-sector partnerships to address the world's most pressing challenges. As CEO of PYXERA Global, she has led the transformation of that organization to one that maximizes impact through strong and strategic partnerships, through cutting-edge programming like Global Pro Bono, local content development, and integrated community development. Deirdre's expertise spans private, public, and social sector experiences. Her social sector tenure at PYXERA Global is complemented by her early career roles at the International Research and Exchanges Board and American Councils. She also has served on the boards of directors of the Volunteers for Economic Growth Alliance and the U.S. Center for Citizen Diplomacy, which is now a signature initiative of PYXERA. Prior to joining PYXERA Global in 2002, Deirdre was a senior manager in the public sector practice at Arthur D. Little, leading projects focused on strategy and organization for the U.S. Agency for International Development, the U.S. Trade and Development Agency, and the European Bank for Reconstruction and Development, along with numerous government agencies across Eurasia. Deirdre began her career in the private sector, working with Welt International, a niche consulting firm engaged in non-conventional means, such as barter and countertrade, of financing international trade ventures. She later expanded her private sector experience as a senior manager in Arthur D. Little's Moscow office, leading post-privatization restructuring efforts for large manufacturing enterprises in Russia and Ukraine. She also served as an organizational development advisor to several of the Eurasian oil and gas sector's largest firms. I spoke with Deirdre in Washington, D.C. Hello, Deirdre. Thank you so much for being on the Terms of Reference podcast today.
Thanks, Stephen, for making the opportunity available. Looking forward to it.
And where am I calling you today?
I am in Washington, D.C. for once today, so that's an exciting change of pace.
Ooh, for once. I'm glad. I hope we get to talk about that. It's April 20th when we're recording this, and so I hope, you know, I can't lie to you. I was actually just in D.C. Spring has sprung. It's gorgeous there.
It's about time. We've been waiting for a very long winter this year.
So, Deirdre, start off by telling us about who you are today professionally. What's your position and who do you work for?
Sure. I work with an organization called PYXERA Global, and I am the CEO of the organization. I have been here for about 13 years now, so quite a while, but I was not always CEO. I've been CEO for 5 years or so. I came on board as the vice president for new business development.
And PYXERA, that, you know, that tells us a little about what the organization does. I know, I did some background research. I know where it came from, but could you tell us the brief story of what PYXERA is?
Sure. Well, actually, we began in 1990. This is our 25th anniversary, but we began under another name at the time, Citizens Democracy Corps, and we've gone through a few names since. We rebranded a couple of years ago under the name PYXERA Global, and we specifically chose a name that was not literal. We thought that this is such a complex field that we're working in, that trying to nail it down to a literal name made no sense whatsoever, so that we really wanted to go with something evocative. And PYXERA comes from, first of all, the word Pyxis, which is an ancient mariner's compass, and we feel that a lot of our role is as navigators, navigating partnerships to improve lives and livelihoods around the world. And it also comes from the word terra. So as much as we're navigators and as much as we're visionaries, we have our feet firmly on the ground and know how to get things done. So PYXERA, Pyxis and terra.
And if you were to explain to us what your core service provision is or your core business, what is it that you would, you know, you'd sell us on?
Everything we do is about enriching lives and livelihoods around the globe. And part of it is what we do, which that could be through capacity building for small and medium enterprises. It could be through capacity building for individuals that want to make a difference in their communities and organizations. But part of what is, I think, a bit unusual about this organization is the how we do it is perhaps not as important as the what we do, but it is absolutely core to it. And that is that everything we do is through public-private social sector partnerships. And we really believe that to affect real change around the world, that the only way we're going to do that is through cross-sector partnerships.
Mm. So public-private social sector partnerships. Could you tell us a story? Like, give us an example of one of those partnerships that you've created or are working on today.
Sure. One of my favorite ones, I just came back from India a week or two ago, where we have a fantastic partnership with John Deere. It's John Deere. It's PYXERA Global. It's the local agricultural university. It's a local NGO and very much tied in with the local government entities in these three villages in rural Rajasthan. And what we're doing there is an integrated community development program where together we are both looking to affect agricultural livelihoods, and then also looking at resiliency around agricultural livelihoods. So, what are the alternatives to ag livelihoods for these very subsistence agrarian communities? We're looking at small scale infrastructure projects and education, and each one of the partners brings a particular set of skills to the table. John Deere not only is funding the project, but they have been deeply involved in conducting the needs assessment and bringing agronomists to the table, for instance, some infrastructure specialists, folks that could really look at what the challenges are. We're involved in the capacity building. How long will PYXERA Global be involved? Well, for the 5 years of this project, but we need to ensure that there's a leave behind, and that's kind of where our skill sets come in. The local NGO that knows the community extremely well has been able to bring all kinds of insights from that side. And of course, collaborating with the local government is extremely important, particularly when you're taking on both infrastructure and education projects. So if you're going to come with a systemic challenge and some systemic resolution to that challenge, you've got to have all of these different sectors involved.
That is fascinating. You've been CEO for 5 years. You've been with PYXERA for 13 years. How did you get started in this business? Did you always know that you wanted to be a development professional? Or, like so many of us, did you kind of stumble your way here?
I absolutely stumbled my way into it. I loved languages, and I had decided to study languages both in high school and in college, and then it's sort of, you graduate with a major in Russian and Soviet studies, and what are you going to do with that now? And so I wanted to find a job that would use my language skills, and I was successful in doing that, both first here in D.C., and I'm a D.C. native, but first here in D.C., and then overseas. I spent 9 years living in Moscow and working all over the countries of the former Soviet Union. But really, my only skill at the time to contribute to the field was language. I didn't have the development background or the enterprise background, any of the things that I ended up working on.
And so was that just the serendipity of working with your employers who were able to train you up? Or is it all, are you sort of just a learn by doing kind of person?
I'm definitely a learn by doing kind of person, but the uniqueness of working in the former Soviet Union, first the Soviet Union, then the former Soviet Union in the early 90s, was that they needed language area specialists and they needed people that understood the culture, and it was easier to train us on the skill sets needed as long as we had the deep language and cultural knowledge than vice versa, than to bring someone in with the skill sets and try to explain Russian culture and try to create language skills on a short timeline. So lots was going on in that area of the world at the time, and the folks of us that were able to cross those cultural boundaries were extremely important to being able to support a lot of programming in the countries at the time. Mm.
It makes a lot of sense for most people listening to this show why a technical expert would be on an airplane most of the time. As the CEO, why are you traveling so much? Is that to keep your hands in each of the programs that you have, or is that for a different reason?
It's actually for a different reason, though I do like to make sure I get out to touch and feel what we're doing on the ground as often as I can, and also to be able to stay in touch with our team members that work all around the world so that we're not just a Washington-centric operation. But more importantly than that, I mentioned earlier that we are unique as an NGO and that our mission is the actual reinvention of the way that the public, private, and social sector come together to address complex challenges. So again, while everything we do is about enriching lives and livelihoods, our mission is actually to bring more organizations along on this journey of understanding how important tri-sector partnership is to affecting change. our vision is a culture of sustained collaboration that affects social impact, that affects change. And so because our mission and vision are in this space of bringing more organizations along on this journey, a lot of the work I do is around thought leadership. And so that means sometimes I'm sitting by myself and writing things, but it also means that a lot of times I'm on a plane to go and speak at various events around the world where there's an audience that we feel is either open to or just needs to hear this message and see some real examples of how much more impact you can have when you get involved in true partnership. And I say true partnership, and I think that that's really important. If you look at every bilateral or multilateral donor agency today, they all have a partnerships office. But our observation has been that the understanding of what partnership really is differs from organization to organization and person to person. And we have a real strong feeling that a partnership has to be something where there is mutual and meaningful benefit for all the parties involved.
Can you give us a concrete example of what that meaningful value would be?
Sure. So one of our areas of business, one thing we do a lot of work in is global pro bono programs. So these are programs where we work with some of the largest companies in the world. We have about 15 multinational corporations, Fortune 500 companies that partner with us to take their top talent and to place them in assignments where they are contributing to some social good. And so, for instance, we are the primary implementing partner for IBM's Corporate Service Corps program, where they send 500 people a year, their top talent, across borders to work with NGOs, local governments, or small businesses to help to solve a business challenge they have that is stopping them from delivering their services to their communities as effectively as they could. And so our job is to go out to find these good local organizations, to do the needs assessment, to create the scopes of work, and then to match the skill sets available from our corporate partners like IBM or FedEx or PepsiCo or Pfizer or Merck, a dozen others. And what the company gets out of it is this is leadership development for them. They're investing in their top talent. This is an opportunity for their top talent to get insights into what it means to work in some of their markets of tomorrow. It's building global teamwork, global partnerships. So, for instance, a team of IBMers comes from at least six different countries and at least six different disciplines within the company. So you're starting to create these really complex networks within a very global corporation that can be isolated by country or function. So that's what the company gets out of it. The organization on the ground obviously gets an opportunity to have access to resources they would never have access to otherwise, to help them to look at some of the challenges they face in a new way and to bring some new solutions to the table. So making sure that both sides are getting something out of it. And I think that that can be uncomfortable in this sector if you feel that the business side, for instance, or the donor side is benefiting from or profiting from the work they're doing. But part of our whole messaging around partnerships is that, in fact, that has to happen, that all of the partners have to be getting some benefit out of it if you want the partnership to continue to be able to deliver value, and that we all need to get comfortable with that concept.
Mm. So how does this work get funded? Are your partners paying you to come and help them do this? Are you getting funding from donor government?
So in the case of the global pro bono programs, we receive either a grant or a contract from our private sector partner to do this work. We do ask the local organizations to have some skin in the game, but usually it's not a cash out of pocket contribution for them. It will be things like local transportation and translation where that's necessary, other sort of support services that are meaningful and that actually do cost those organizations. They are investing something in this program, but that they don't actually have to, they don't have to contribute a check out of pocket, if you will.
How do you measure success at the end of the day?
I think that's one of the biggest challenges in this whole space. We're all looking to contribute our own small part to making the world a better place, but how do we measure it? And I think that what's most challenging about that is this is that across the board, it's behavioral change that's necessary for our small contributions to matter in the long run. And given that most of the projects any of us work on are 2 to 5 years long, how and when do you get to measure that impact? I think we see small successes that we can hold up and say, we think that this project, we think that this effort is going well because we've seen this type of change. But one thing we have done at PYXERA Global, again, because it's our 25th anniversary this year, we have invested significant resources out of pocket to go out and to look back over 25 years and what has been the impact of our work along 10 different theme lines of work we've done, from global pro bono to enterprise development to agribusiness development. And we're going around the world and we're looking back at whether we worked 5 years ago or 10 years ago or 20 years ago in a location. How did the organizations we worked with and the people that worked with us or even for our organizations, how did their lives change over time? And one thing, Stephen, that we have been clear about is that we're going to be really honest about what we found here, both the good, the bad, and the ugly. And I think that that's something that is so missing in this space, that we do not go back often enough and say, wow, what was really not a good use of money at best? And hopefully we don't find a lot of things where there was actually harm done. But I think it's so critical in this field for all of us to be open to doing that kind of assessment, and also for more of the funding partners we work with to be willing to fund that kind of stuff, because it's not every organization that is willing or able to come up with funds to go back and take that kind of look.
You're celebrating 25 years, which is a huge milestone. Congratulations. What do you think the next 5 years looks like, or the next 10 years look like? How is the organization continuing to evolve? How are you continuing to evolve? What do you think the next move is?
It's a great question right now, because this is something that we are struggling with a lot internally. We have grown an enormous amount over the last 5 years. We have essentially almost quintupled in size of both staff and revenues. And one of the questions that we have asked to our team across the world is, how much bigger do we want to be? And the resounding response to that question has been not all that much bigger. And I think that that's really important in how we think about the kind of projects and partnerships that we pick out, what we decide we can contribute the most to social change with, the types of partnerships, again, and the types of projects. I think it's also very instructive to us in terms of this influence agenda that we have, trying to bring others along on the journey. So if we don't want to be that much larger than we are, what are the implications in terms of how we work with and bring other NGOs along that could foster the same kind of partnerships that we have in place? So I think that we'll be spending a fair amount of time over the next couple of years really narrowing down not the specific partners, but the types of partnerships, and then also how we are able to build capacity outside of this. The other thing that is extremely important to us right now is taking a look at the Sustainable Development Goals. We are concerned at the way they read now, because they are so broad and so immeasurable, frankly. We understand that this is probably the way that they are going to be presented to the UN for ratification in September. And given that, we have created a tool internally to try to narrow them down to the 9 areas where we think as an organization, we, together with our partners and the types of partnerships we have, can have any kind of meaningful impact toward those goals. So thinking about how we can align with the Sustainable Development Goals, how we can be realistic about them, and how we can select partnerships and programming to be able to be very focused in the way that we contribute to social change in the coming years.
My ears perked up when you told me you've quintupled in the last 5 years. What was it about the last 5 years that made that possible? Was it a change in programming? Was it, you know, you were serendipitously placed in the right place at the right time? Aggressive business development? What happened? Wait, you became CEO.
Well, no, not just that. My predecessor was very much dedicated to partnerships as well, and I certainly learned an enormous amount from him that led us along this line. I think a couple of different things happened. One is there has been a dramatic change in the private sector's thinking about the way they need and want to collaborate with the NGO community. In fact, the private sector has been moving much more rapidly than the public or social sectors in terms of understanding the value of partnerships. I think that because we have been open to these types of partnerships, because we have worked really hard to change our own internal structure as well as our language around the work we do, we have been a partner of choice. So it hasn't been so much aggressive business development as people have sought us out to work with us because they know that we have a very good track record of working with the private sector, and we have for more than a decade now. So part of that is just having positioned ourselves well and having partnered well with those who have the ability to fund the kind of projects we want to be able to work on. I think it's also that we have within our staff what I would call tri-sector leaders, so people that have experience in the public, private, and social sectors. And so they really know how to straddle the needs. Again, the language is really important across sectors. They know how to listen for what the priorities are across each of these sectors and come up with a model that does serve all of the partners. And that has been a key to an absolute key to our success.
Mm. Good old hard work, it sounds like.
Good old hard work. A lot of hard, you know, and let me say, I think this is important too for organizations that are thinking about how do we change our business model. We, and I'm always very honest about this, we nearly put ourselves out of business doing it. So it is not an easy transition to make. I think it becomes easier today as there are more potential partners out there that are looking for these kind of arrangements. But when we started along this path more than a decade ago, we had some really, really rough years. And you talk about hard work. I'm amazed that some of the people that have been here for 13 years are still here and went through those roller coaster moments with us when we really weren't sure that we were going to be able to change our model so much. And when I say we changed it so much, 12 years ago, we were 100% funded by USAID, 100%. Today, we're less than 10% funded by USAID with a smattering of World Bank funding, and the rest of our funding comes through our partnerships with the private sector.
So tell me this, I mean, you've just touched on that. Why did people stay? Was it because they were a part of a family that they believed in to the end? Was it because they didn't have other opportunities elsewhere? Was it because you and the former CEO were able to communicate a vision that they were able to buy into? What do you think was the special sauce there?
I think that those who stayed and those who are on our team now really believe in approaching the development field differently. And in fact, we don't even talk about development within this organization any longer. We try to avoid that term. We think that it is that it has a lot of negative connotations today, both in terms of the nomenclature itself and also just in terms of what development, some of the challenges with development programs around the world, that development is about doing something to someone, whereas we talk about purposeful global engagement, which is about doing something with someone. And again, going to this idea of mutual and meaningful benefit. I think language is really powerful. And we try to weight our language with terms that we think are much more based in an equal relationship of the various players at the table. We don't use the term beneficiaries, which is pretty standard in this area of work as well. It's not just about the terminology. That the terminology is a reflection of who we are as an organization and how we go about our work and the people that work in this organization. And I pinch myself every day when I walk in the office that I get to call this a job, because I work with incredibly talented, passionate folks who really want to make a difference, who believe that some of what has been done in the international development arena over the last 50 years has not been nearly as effective as it could have been, and that are really committed to bringing new solutions to the table by bringing new kinds of resources to the table to help to solve old problems. So they are true believers.
True believers in a different sense. I sometimes use that in a negative way.
They're true believers that there's a better way. While certainly our work is in no way perfect, we are trying very hard to understand what those better ways are and to commit ourselves to making a difference in that way.
And I have to follow up with this. So having gone from 100% USAID funding to, you know, a smattering, as you say, which I love, have you found yourself an outcast in DC now? Or are others look to you and say, gosh, how did you do that? And they're trying to replicate your model? Or
people either love what we're doing and are trying to replicate it. And we spend a lot of time. Everyone on the senior team here is asked on a weekly basis, sort of tell us how you did it. And we are absolutely willing always to share those stories. I think that, yes, there certainly is an audience here in DC, and not a small one, where our willingness to partner as deeply with the private sector as we do is not all that welcome. It is fairly standard for an organization doing the kind of capacity development work that we do to be willing to take a check from the private sector, but to actually walk hand in hand down the street together and co-create something in a very public way is not necessarily comfortable in this world yet. We're working to make it more comfortable. We think a lot more people need to do it. And Stephen, one of the things I firmly believe, as I said, the private sector is moving much faster than the public or social sector are. And that's not a good thing either, because you don't want all of these private sector corporations out there just deciding they know how to engage with communities, how to engage in these types of programs on their own. They need the partnership of the civil society organizations, and they need the partnership of the government. And if they're not getting it at the level and depth that they need to, you know, I fear that that's not a good thing either, because they're going to have to move forward on their own.
Mm. That brings us back to a question we wanted to talk about. Could you tell us a story about a time when you think an organization or a partnership that you created, it didn't work out, and what you learned from it as an organization?
Well, I can tell you about one that didn't work out temporarily, and then that we were able to revive. And I think that's part of partnership. So with one particular private sector partner, we had done some infrastructure work, again, small scale infrastructure. We're not an infrastructure organization, but where there is a community need for a particular type of repair that we can train individuals in the community to build up a skill set so that they can, for instance, repair and then maintain a well. In this case, it wasn't a well, but you know, there's a lot of building of infrastructure, and then there's no creating of the skill sets to maintain the infrastructure. So we had a small-scale infrastructure project where the private sector partner came and took a look, and they said, you know, that's not up to our standards. That is not spit polished in the way that we would do it in our headquarters in the United States. And so we want you to tear up the work that you did and bring in professional masons from a capital city to recreate this. And this was one of those situations where we actually had to put down our feet and refuse. We said, this infrastructure is safe. It is absolutely appropriate for the local environment. It was built by local women masons that were trained specifically for this activity. And if we tear it up and bring in outsiders to do it, besides the fact that it's a big waste of money, it sends the absolute wrong message to this community about what they're able to do for themselves. And if you come in with your spit polished you know, with your spit-polished infrastructure, I assure you it's not going to be maintained by the community in the same way that what was done by these women that everyone knows. It's going to create a problem. And so if that's what you want to do, then you need to find another partner to do it. And we were very passionate in the argument we made, and we were very, very willing to walk away. And I think that that's also something that is too often missing in this space, is that when you know you're doing something that is not good for the communities or organizations or individuals you're working with, we have to be willing to walk away from it, even though as an NGO, we're all so tied financially and need to be able to keep our heads financially above water. It's hard to walk away from something that someone's, you know, willing to give you the funds to do, but we just have to be willing to do it. And further to that, Stephen, you know, one of the problems with the international, with the bilateral and multilateral donors is that we get into these contractual relationships with them where a need is determined 5 years ago, not necessarily with full engagement of the community in the process of determining the need. And a couple of months down the line, or a couple of years down the line, you find that's really not what's needed any longer. And I can't tell you how many times over the years that we were funded by bilateral and multilateral donors, we were told, well, that's what the contract says. You have to do that. It doesn't matter whether it's needed or not. So changing our mentality as a sector from what is needed versus what I want to give is absolutely critical today. It was critical a long time ago, but hopefully we're all starting to come to a point where we understand we need to delve into what is needed. We need to be prepared to address that and move away from what I want to give.
Deirdre, this last question is one that I ask every guest here on Terms of Reference, and that's, I'm a little remiss in asking it in the way I usually do, because it's always about how do you become a development professional? But if you were to encounter someone who's coming out of an MBA or coming out of a master's degree, or someone who's interested in transitioning into this sector that you have been working in for the last 25 years, what's your one or two critical pieces of advice about how to create sustainability and satisfaction in that career?
Well, first, I mean, as you're starting, meet everyone you can in this space and learn what they do and how they do it, and find out what gets you the most exciting. And also find an organization where you like the vibe, because when you're choosing a career in this global engagement space, by its nature, it's more than a job. The fact that you are choosing this as a career probably means you're looking for it to be much more than a job. So make sure you feel good about what you're doing, how you're doing it, and the people that you're doing it with. And if you don't, you know, don't hesitate to change.
Deirdre, thank you so much for your time today. This has been a fascinating conversation.
Thank you very much, Stephen. I appreciate it and look forward to hearing more of your cast.
You've been listening to the Terms of Reference podcast from aidpreneur.com. Subscribe to us on iTunes.